All right, everybody ready?
Indeed.
Good evening. Thank you for being here. We're getting to a part, a point in the year where a lot of things are going on, a lot of activities, and I know that you've got things as well. So, tonight we're gonna have a little bit of a modified version of our meeting. We spend a couple hours almost every time talking about what the topic is. We don't spend that 2 hours. We've got one of our high school soccer teams, Elsick High School, is in the quarters or the regional semifinals of the soccer playoffs, state playoffs. So they're playing tonight at Cinco Ranch, and I quite frankly will get killed if I don't make an appearance at that game, so I've got to get over to that game. And so we're going to spend some time on a relevant topic, and we're going to probably exit out of here about 7:15, 7:30, or I don't know if it takes, if that's okay with you guys. But I want this to be worth your time. A couple of quick updates. The legislation issues, if those of you that have been a part of that conversation, discussion, some of the more critical components of the legislation that we've been working on have moved fairly quickly. The graduation plans and the test reduction legislation is a third of the way there. It passed out of the House of Representatives a couple of weeks ago. It's in the Senate right now. It'll be heard in the Senate over the next couple of days, either Thursday or Tuesday next week. If it survives that, it'll be two-thirds of the way, and then the final third will be going to the governor's desk for a signature. That's a big hurdle right now for the governor. So anyway, that legislation that we've talked about is progressing quite nicely. The other piece of legislation, Deanna, Ms. Wentz will cover this in just a little bit, has to do with funding, public school funding and the financing. She'll give you an idea of where we were a couple of years ago as the state was reducing funding for public schools, and then where it seems like or seems the direction we may be going. But that leads into what our conversation topic is tonight. It's school finance. And when Deanna asked me what were y'all kind of expecting, and I said, well, it's kind of a school finance 101. To certain degrees, you've probably heard how schools are funded and the levels once they're funded and how that complex system actually ends up reaching our classrooms and the amount of money we pay. Well, that's sort of kind of giving an overview of how the budget works at the state level in terms of how it impacts us, how it impacts you as a taxpayer. That's probably fairly important to you, regardless of where you live, because of the way schools are funded locally in Texas. And then kind of some comments about what we're looking for the 13-14 year, things that we're trying to prepare for, even though the session is still less than 2 months away from being wrapped up. And I will tell you that any time our Texas legislature is in session, it's really difficult to make firm decisions on your budget until they actually bang the gavel and then we know kind of where the chips are going to fall. We have ideas right now. We have projections, forecasts based on the direction they're going. She'll talk a little bit. So that's going to be the topic tonight. So feel free to talk about money as a district. We're in the middle of building a budget, working with the board on building the budget, talking to various groups. You are obviously one of those groups we wanted to talk to and provide information, but also allow you to provide some insight and suggestions. So, any questions?
When do you think you'll finalize your budget? I understand fully that uncertainty until the legislature.
We'll bring a formal recommended budget at the end of August. We're a September or August fiscal year. Several districts around us, Spring Ranch, I believe, is one of them.
Mid-year.
sometimes go July to June. Yeah, July 1 to June. So, but it'll be towards the end of August. Any questions? All right, I'm going to introduce Ms. Deanna Wentz. She is our Chief Financial Officer for the district. I can't begin to tell you how fortunate this district is to have her and her knowledge and her abilities. I joke with her all the time, but she's seriously, as a taxpayer in this district, you want someone like Deanna managing your money. So she does it in a way in which the board expects, the superintendent expects. And she learned from a good one when Dr. Sterner was here, one of the more brighter school finance minds in Texas. Anyway, Deanna's going to share with you a little bit about what's going on financially with our district.
All right. Thank you for that wonderful introduction. I'm Deanna Wentz, and I'm going to start tonight. Just talking in general about how a district manages their finance system. We have a lot of restrictions attached to the money that we receive in the school district. We have external restrictions from grantors or from the federal government or from the state when they provide money to us. And then we have internal restrictions as far as our board of directors adopting the budget, and that is our overall guiding financial plan for the year. So we use separate funds, or you can think of it as like separate checking accounts, to track the money coming in and the money going out of each of those separate pools of money or those separate funds. The main fund that we operate with is the general fund. In that fund, we receive state and local revenue, and a very small amount of our federal revenue is tracked in that fund. And that covers all the general expenditures for operating the school district. So the majority of our teacher salaries, supplies and materials in the classroom, the electricity bills, the day-to-day operations of the school district are funded through the general fund. We assess the tax rate for that general fund separately from any other component of our tax rate. A lot of times you'll hear people talk about the M&O rate, the maintenance and operations rate. All of the money from that tax rate, which is currently $1.12.5, goes into our general fund along with state revenues, and that's how we operate on a day-to-day basis. We also have the debt service fund. We get state revenue used in that fund also, as well as the other portion of our tax rate, which is called the INS tax rate, interest in sinking. That's used to repay debt that the school district has issued. So nothing else flows through that fund. Money comes into it from the state and from that segregated portion of our tax rate, and the only expenditures or expenses out of that fund are repayment of our debt. We have other funds called capital project funds. That's where if the district does issue debt, which we haven't done in the past several years, but are getting ready to do in the near future for some projects. When we issue those bonds, that money goes into a capital projects fund. We report back to the board on how that money is spent on a monthly basis, and those are expenditures for big ticket items, expansion, construction, renovation. Then we have all our special revenue funds, which is where we account for the majority of our grants. When we adopt our annual budget each year, the only funds included are the general fund, the debt service fund, and the food service fund. Our general fund budget is about $256 million. Debt service fund, those annual payments to repay debt that's been issued over many years, is $29 million. And our food service fund is about $22 million. So those are the only funds that the board adopts an annual budget. That doesn't include capital project funds I talked about or our special revenue funds. Those special revenue funds are about $32 million. The majority of that is like title funding out at campuses and Idea B for special ed kids and things like that. So the process we use when we work through the general fund budget with the board, we start in about January of each year. That goes through August, and to answer the question at the beginning, our fiscal year runs September 1st through August 31st, so we have to adopt our budget prior to September 1st. That's typically the last board meeting in August. We start it, though, back in January, so it's about an eight-month process working through various groups and various processes before we make final recommendations to the board for adoption. staffing is the biggest component. About 90% of our expenses are for staff. About 64% of our expenses are for teacher staff. So, you know, we're a people business, and that's where the majority of our funds, of course, are spent. To determine our staffing out of the campuses, each campus receives their teacher allocations based on the number of students projected to be at their campus by grade level, and then separated at each grade level between monolingual and bilingual. And we have set ratios that we use to determine how to fund them. In elementary, it's 22 students to one. I'm sure you've heard that discussed a lot before, the cap on number of students in the classroom at elementary. And then that varies at each of the other levels. For the non-teacher allocations at campuses, assistant principals, counselors, paraprofessionals, elected teachers, those are all based on the campus size also. We have other requests for new personnel each year. Those are presented to Superintendent's Council first through our Human Resources Department. And then once that council agrees on them, they're presented to the Board of Trustees, typically in June during the legislative year. We can't really make all of our staffing decisions prior to knowing our revenue, which we won't know until the end of May. Sometimes when the legislature is not in session, we're able to present that staffing plan earlier. And then the total budget is presented in August. So some of the key financial facts that go into building our budget: enrollment is the first and most critical step in building the budget. You can see over the last several years, the district's enrollment has flattened. It hasn't shifted by more than 1% in about 6 years now. So we've leveled off on enrollment growth. We're not losing a lot of students, not gaining a lot of students either. That can be a good thing in that we're not having to build a lot of new facilities. We can concentrate our funds on renovating the existing facilities that we do have. We use enrollment to determine, like I said, how we're going to staff our campuses, how we're going to supply our campuses with their allocation for materials and supplies. But it's also a big factor in determining our state funded, because we're funded by the state on a per student basis. So you have to get those enrollment estimates right in order to reliably predict your revenue for the next year.
Why do we have that peak?
The peak in 05-06 was Katrina Rita's students. And then you can see where a lot of those students left, or other students left, in 06-07, we came back down, and then we've been hovering right around 45,000 since that time. As I mentioned earlier, 89%, about 90% actually, for this current year, is in payroll and related expenditures. So that's the salary costs, as well as costs for substitutes, the cost for health insurance for our employees, Medicare, all the things related to funding staffing. Raise is a big component in trying to determine our budget. You can see we have not had a raise for the last 2 years in this district, and before that we had a history of always being able to provide additional compensation each year. The large number in 06-07, the 5.3% raise, is when the state provided additional funding to school districts and mandated that it be used for a raise. So that number is kind of out of whack with the rest of our standard percentages. We were able in the 12-13 year to give a $1,000 supplement to all staff in lieu of a permanent raise. That was positive and negative for many staff people. We did not provide it in the form of a permanent raise because we didn't know what the legislature was going to do this year, and so we weren't able to guarantee we'd be able to sustain that over time. We did have the funds available for 12-13 only and provided that stipend. When you look at the raise percentages, you can see that each 1% increase in salary, although it's about $552 for a teacher on the midpoint, it costs overall in the district budget $2.5 million. And then you can do the math down from there to see how that number grows as each percent increases. We won't be making a decision this year on a salary increase until the June board meeting, which will be after, again, we know our revenue. Other expenditures, the campus allocations. You can see campuses are allocated on a per pupil basis, starting at $93 at elementary, moving up to $112 at high school. Other big ticket items in our budget would be utilities. That's about $12 million a year. We have been able to reduce that significantly over the last couple years with energy conservation measures headed up by our maintenance department. So we've seen about a $2 million reduction in that line item of our budget, which has been very positive. Technology expenditures, we spend about $2 million out of our general fund for just general replacement cycle computers each year, vehicle fuel, and other big ticket items. And then the campuses use these funds on average about $83,000 for an elementary, up to about $322,000 for a high school for supplies, materials, other needed items at their campuses. That's the part the principal basically has control over. Property value is another big factor in building our budget. It determines not only the amount of taxes we'll collect, so we have to estimate what we think the property value will be for the next year, but it also determines your state funding. So the way the state funding formula works, I'll talk about in a few minutes, but once you know your property value and the tax rate, then you just determine how much the local revenue will be from those taxes. You can see, well, it's actually very hard to see, but our M&O rate, or general fund rate, has been at $1.12.5 for the last 5 years, since the tax ratification election in the fall of 2008. Prior to that, it was at $1.04. 2 years back from that, it was at $1.50. 05-06 is the year that the state decided that they needed to compress local tax rates or bring those local tax rates down and provided additional funding to districts in order to make up for that revenue. So most districts at that time were at $1.50 along with A-League, and then over a 2-year time period we reduced that rate down to $1.04, and then it stayed there until the following year when the voters approved an increase in the rate to $1.12. Completely separate from that is our INS rate, or the debt service rate. That's calculated based on our estimates of property value and then what we know our expenditures will be for the next year for debt service. As I said, we're not building a lot of buildings, not issuing a lot of debt, so that tax rate has been able to be reduced over time. It was at 22.5 cents back in 07, 08, and then it was reduced by a penny. Held at that level, reduced by another penny, and 11-12 reduced by another penny for 12-13. We're projecting a decrease in this current year also, and we'll know how much, whether that will be one penny or two pennies by the time we finally make recommendations to the board in August. So state and local revenue in the general fund. The state formulas are set up so that each district is able to receive a certain amount of money per student. The state determines that amount of money, and based on the type of students. So it's not just the students that are enrolled, but the number of days they actually come to school. So they calculate our average daily attendance based on the days they're actually present in the classroom, and then certain students generate additional funding, such as special education students, career and technology, bilingual. There's several categories of students that receive what they call weighted funding or additional funding above that base amount. So that's how we get from our adjusted daily attendance up to our weighted adjusted daily attendance. A lot of times you may hear people talk about WADA, which the district's WADA. Our average daily attendance is about 43,000. Once you weight that number for the number of students that meet those requirements of GT, bilingual, compensatory ed, students at risk, that number is about 56,000. So because we're a fairly high needs district, there's a pretty big gap between our weighted ADA and our ADA. So that's how the state recognizes that for some students it takes more dollars, more resources to educate those students and provides a little bit of additional funding. So once they calculate through all the complicated formulas, the number of students that have been in attendance, what type of students those were, and then the various allocations of resources for each of those groups. You come up with your total base level of funding. Once you have that amount, based on the district's property value, they say, okay, this is the amount the district will pay, and this is the amount the state will pay. So property value plays a big part in determining how much we'll get both locally and from the state. So basically they're saying, this is how much you need to run a basic program at your schools. The state will fund the portion that you're not able to raise locally. How it's supposed to work. But then we have the target revenue system that began in 06-07 and was based on the amount of revenue per weighted student that we received in 05-06, and that's where a lot of the vast differences in funding amounts came about with districts. They've done some modifications to that system since that time, but the formulas still remain intact the way I described them a few minutes ago, but then they say, okay, that's how much the formulas generate for your school district, but you're set at this target amount that was based and frozen on what you were receiving in 05-06. So we're going to compare that to the amount the formulas generate. If the formulas don't generate enough to get you to that target, you get additional funding. If they do, then you're stuck at that same level. So it's hard to explain exactly how it works or why it works the way it is, and we'll talk about that in a few minutes when we talk about the lawsuit. But you can see that ALEAF is funded much less on a per-student basis than the majority of the districts surrounding us. We receive about $5,059 per weighted student. You look way off to the end, and that you can see that Lamar receives almost $600 more per student. Katie, Spring Branch, Stafford, we're at the low end of the funding equation because of this target revenue system that's been here since 05-06. I'll jump down to that second bullet because it really ties in with the target revenue discussion. In the last year, several school districts joined together to sue the state, and I think Mr. Chambers has talked about that suit with this group over the unconstitutional funding of school districts in Texas. So the arguments were that the system was inefficient in that it lacks equity between students, and then equity to taxpayers. Many of those districts that I showed as receiving more per student than ALEAF also have a lower tax rate than ALEAF. So the fact that we had to increase our tax rate, go to the voters for that increase, because we weren't being funded at the same levels as surrounding districts, is where the taxpayer inequity argument comes in. Also that it did not provide adequate revenue for the general diffusion of knowledge, and that it was essentially a state property tax. So the judge ruled in the district's favor in that case that it was indeed unconstitutional under the Texas Constitution, the way that school districts were being funded. That suit will be moving to the Supreme Court, and hopefully we'll have a favorable ruling at that level also. However, we think the legislature is already starting to respond to those results at the district court level. The current version of both the House and Senate bills do provide additional funding to ALEAF and other districts over the next 2 years. And districts like ALEAF that are on the low end of the funding currently will be receiving more than some of the districts that are on the high end. I try not to get too excited at this time of year when we do all the calculations and we can see how to adjust the formulas and calculate what we think we will get in additional revenue, because I can't count the number of times I've done that during a legislative session, and then when May comes and everything's said and done, it's not at all what we thought it would be. So it is currently passed in the House, and the Senate will be hearing it probably next week or the week after. And the two versions are different, so they'll go to conference committee to determine the ultimate funding for school districts. So we are cautiously optimistic at this time. We think the court case, as well as a lot of the cuts that were made to public education and the public outcry as a result of that after the last session, have gotten the attention of some of the legislators, and we are hopeful that we'll get back up to the funding levels that we had in 10-11. So we're really not looking to have more. That would basically mean that we're just back to where we were 2 years ago, and everyone knows inflation and everything else has happened since then, but we would be pleased to be able to allocate additional resources out to our campuses and students. So our next step, our current step, is talking to a lot of different groups about how we see funding falling out for ALEAF for this next biennium, kind of a review of where we've been, where we think we may be going. We've talked to all these different groups up here. Today's been a busy day with Mr. Chambers talking to the Student Advisory Council to just kind of get a feel from them about how their school is funded. The Education Improvement Council meeting met this afternoon. This group will continue to talk to our school board between now and August when the budget is ultimately adopted. And we always look at our district priorities in making all of our budget decisions. The board sets those priorities. The board makes sure that they're allocating the resources necessary to help us meet those priorities. So the priorities are to close the achievement gap to ensure that all students reach their academic potential, improve student preparation for college and career, maintain safe and orderly environment, recruit, develop, and retain highly qualified and effective personnel, and build positive relationships with all stakeholders. So that basically wraps up the presentation part of it. I'd be glad to answer any questions about the information that I presented or go back and review a certain area if it was unclear to the group. But we'd also like to hear your thoughts on how you see the state of the finances in ALEAF. Major budget areas that we've talked about are, of course, personnel, employee compensation. Tutorials for students have definitely risen to the top in all of our budget conversations. A lot of those have been funded with federal dollars in the past, and that funding went away, and our students are definitely needing additional intervention. Instructional technology is, of course, a big topic. Materials and supplies and just other needs in the district or community, needs from a taxpayer standpoint. We'd love just to kind of hear your thoughts, discussion, questions during this time. Yes, sir.
Could you go back to the slide on the property values, about six or seven slides back?
Yes, sir.
And what was the percent change from last year to this year?
Last year, okay, from 11-12 to 12-13, it was 1.37%. Okay. Very small increase.
And do you already know what it is for next year? Or
we do not.
Right, okay. So how close are you to HCAT on this? Do you have a red zone to them or something, a red folder? Or, you know, can you just kind of go, hey, we think it's going to be 2.3 this year because everything's happening? I mean, what's your process on figuring out and calculating your property taxes? Because as you can see, it does go up for a number of years, but then
right.
It starts to go down, and
correct.
Maybe it's going back up again. Who knows?
Right. HCAD provides the value to us. So we get the values from them. They give us what's called a certified estimate at the end of April, which is by category within the district, residential, commercial, industrial, what they think values will end up being, but then there's still the whole process of taxpayer protests and all those things that occur after that before they give us our final certified values in August. So they provide us with the estimates. We kind of look at that and say, you know, we think they're
a little more conservative.
Typically, yeah. We're a little more conservative. Like for this past year, I believe we had a 1% increase, and it ended up being 1.37. So we never really know until later in the year what our property values were.
Right, and it moves around because of protests.
Yes, and it continues to move.
Right.
All
so
the year.
So then you're getting an estimate on April and kind of basing your budget on that, and then it really finalizes itself. It's never really locked, but it's close. In
right.
August, and that's still enough time in August to meet with the board to adopt the budget and move forward. Is that kind of how it works?
That's exactly how it works.
So you don't have to have a red phone to them. They're giving you the information.
Yeah, they're required required to certify the information to us to build our budget.
We also go get some other indicator data before that on, for instance, on the trend is going down on foreclosure rates and so forth. So that helps indicate to us if residential's decline or if on the business side we keep track of, like in the West Chase District, do breaking ground and some of those bigger projects that are going to add value, whether or not that's going to be the rolls this year or next.
So I guess that brings me to that question. Where are you for next year? What are you projecting?
We're projecting about flat for next year. We're seeing some continued increases in the business side and continued decreases or leveling off of the decreases on the residential side.
I heard something a week or two ago. It wasn't from HCAD about commercial property going up by 26%.
Oh, wow.
And it's an outrageous.
Thank God, but at the same time,
look at how much our taxpayers get taxed over all these other surrounding districts per penny, what we have to do is bring in so much less in money. It's just not fair. Now, that's why we went to took it to the court. So, on behalf of the taxpayers, I think it's going to be good. Hopefully, we're going to get more. We have that great decision to make at that time.
Yeah, but it sounds like you would do a combination in theory.
I think we could save people money and
just give time relief to the taxpayers.
Bringing down the teacher, pupil teacher ratio is the biggest thing that makes it a benefit to the kids.
Okay.
I think there's two things. Since I'm in the room, I'm going to respond.
Oh, you came back?
I came back. I've overheard what I was talking about. Seriously, I think what Charles and Deanna said are very accurate. There is a, and it's sometimes a deserved perception, and then sometimes it's undeserved because some do it, not all, paintbrushes used for all of us. But in terms of what's efficient and what's not, I don't know what's efficient. We throw that word around a lot, but I couldn't tell you what's efficient. Is efficient student scoring at a certain level and tax rate at a certain level, is that the kind of efficiency? So I'm really not sure what efficient is. But I will tell you that based on the definition that we have, this district and there are other districts across the state in this area that have demonstrated that within the rules we're bound to play by, both on the formula side, the funding side, and on the student performance side, I think there are some pretty good barometers and parameters in terms of whether they're efficient or not. But what would we do with seriously flow the money? Part of our efficiency would be to keep the taxpayer in mind. But I also think part of our efficiency would be keep our students in mind. And are there things, are there resources that we can now provide that we might otherwise not be able to provide? And we're sitting there, this is a real situation. What Deanna talked about, whether it's the lawsuit or not, there's a strong chance that we're going to see, quote unquote, new money, some additional revenues for the next 2 years. Not to the levels they were before they were cut 2 years ago, but it's going to be some additional revenues. On the best case side of it, it could potentially be $12 million next year of new money. It could be even more in 14, 15. So there's almost a real life scenario of what your question is. So how do we address that? I think what's important, and she went to them real quick, but I think they're important to remember, is the priorities that you set as a district. Whether it's the board goals or whether it's the priorities that I work with, the administration, the superintendent, work with the board, and we begin identifying what's important. And I will tell you right now what's important to me let's move on from the taxpayer perspective. Let's assume we've been able to address the taxpayer. But as it relates to where would I spend money? Yes, I would try to compensate our staff in a reasonable way. Even beyond that, I think there are areas we need to pay more attention to. And one of them is in our development of our career technology workforce development programs. There were meaningful programs that allow students to graduate high school with meaningful certificates and certifications in meaningful career area opportunities in conjunction with Houston Community College. We do an okay job. Not that we don't want to do a great job, but there's some limitations on it. But that's one area. Early childhood. Pre-K. I would love to have the resources to come in here and offer full day pre-K for every eligible pre-K child in this district. Pre-K being defined as 4-year-olds or 4-year-olds, basically. We run half day pre-Ks now. We have a group of kids that come in the morning, they go home at lunch, we have another group of kids that come in the afternoon, they go home obviously at the end of the school day. The reason we do that is because we don't have the facilities. If we had a full day, if you went to every class being full day, then you're basically doubling the number of classrooms. Quite we don't have that many classes. So things like that. There's those are just two quick examples. We can eat that $20 million up in the
hole. Sure. And what percent of $24 million be in the budget?
The total budget's $350.
So 10% is $35 million. So that's going to be roughly 15%.
Okay.
Well, I want to be real clear about the priorities. Those are important. I think we have to make it. And And I have been, not in this district, but I've been in other districts in situations where the priorities and goals were something that we just agreed upon, and they were pretty good in the binder of the improvement plan. They weren't ever really used as a roadmap. We do our best to use that document, to use those priorities as a roadmap to the best of our ability, so that we're spending money in areas that we come up that we thought were important. Safety and security is a huge deal right now. We've had that conversation. We don't have enough money to make our campuses safe and secure to prevent bad things like what happened in Connecticut back then. We couldn't do that even if we wanted to. So those are areas we're looking at right now that we're taking some additional some revenues that we weren't expecting that we're having. And we're going to spend some money on that, particularly to our elementary and intermediate schools. So there's things that are meaningful, and I think most reasonable taxpayers would say, yeah, go ahead and spend that money on there instead of giving me half a penny tax decrease. As long as they're well thought out, and they're explained, and people kind of understand the logic of it. So if you take that 20 million and you go build you a new whatever, I mean something, you know, I need to pick on something because then it'll be.
But, soccer stadium.
But if you go out and you renovate the superintendent's office. If you buy him or her new furniture, you can trust me, come to the office, I'll show you. But anyway, things like that, if you have a good record on being thoughtful and being reasonable about how you spend money, I think taxpayers will appreciate and understand when you make decisions where you do have to spend some money. And this district has no problem, in my opinion, with credibility in that area with their taxpayers.
You showed those water values, but do you have a comparative slide showing the tax rate between the joint districts?
I do. I just see it in this presentation.
We can take this and have Craig send a PDF of this presentation out to everybody and include that.
Yeah. You know, a couple of years ago, my memory's not as good as it used to be, but when it was going before the legislature, I guess it was maybe 05-06, I remember Sarah Winkler talking about this golden penny or something, or magic penny. I guess that phrase is gone away.
It's still there. I didn't want to get into the penny. So I talked about that first component of funding is based on the number of students and the days they're here and the weight of those students. The next component, which is much, much smaller, is those golden pennies. So it's any taxes the district levies above the $1.04 tax rate. So when you most likely heard her talking about it was during the ratification election and saying, well, if we increase our tax rate by a penny, we get about $1 million from that penny, but we also get additional state funding of about $2 million from those. So that's why they call them golden, was because they generated not only local but state revenue also.
And here's where the rub comes in on that. We have a neighbor to the south, it's north of Spring Branch. Their pennies are worth a lot more than our pennies. What makes them worth a lot more is just the value of the property in Spring Branch versus the total value of the property they have. So for every penny they raise, they get a greater amount of money than we do. Now, you really want to get into the weeds on school finance and funding. Their penny generates enough money that now it kicks them into what's called Robinhood status, where they have to share some of the revenue that their penny generates. And I get to have my good friend down in Spring Branch gripe at me because he's losing money, having to pay back some of the money his local taxpayers paid to Spring Branch. While we keep all of our pennies, or all the money that our penny generates, but our penny generates a lot less, as she's going to show you. So you get into this, going back to the golden penny, in A-League, the reason A-League was able to go after additional pennies above that $1.04, back in 05, $1.04 was kind of the magic on the M&O side, it was the magic number. If you went above it,
there was between $1.04, well, $1.05 and $1.06 were your golden pennies. Well, you can go after those $1.05, that fifth and sixth penny, and it not be subject to the Robin Hood status. In other words, the state won't take any of it from you. But once you get to $1.07 on up, then the state comes back in and takes their, depending on what revenue district you're in, and they take their share of it. So you get into some really complex issues, and when you start trying to compare districts to districts to districts, the easiest way to compare them is to look at what a penny on the tax rate generates. What's a penny for $1 million? So take all those $121 pennies or 119.5 pennies that we have, and multiply that by one, basically, and you get about $120 million. This is a round number. And then the state will kick in some money for us. But if our penny was worth $5 million a penny, like some pennies are out there across some districts, then they're going to have so much revenue that the state comes in and says, we're going to take some of that, equalize you back down to a certain level. That's where you get the Robin Hood district.
But it's only to a certain level, because you look at like Spring Branch, that is one of those districts giving money back and complaining about having to do that, but they're still getting way more per student than what we get, even with giving back some of their money that they're needing to generate.
Full disclosure, I used to be in one of those districts. Stafford is a district just like Spring Branch. I used to be on the other side of that, giving, quote-unquote, giving taxpayer, Stafford taxpayer money back to the state to be redistributed to those who did not have as much money. And so that's been around since the mid-90s. So, but that is a very critical component of how schools are funded.
I wanted to ask you, since you have been on both sides of those playing fields, what is the disconnect from those school districts that is participating or being forced to participate in the Robin Hood and those that aren't? Why is it that those that are in there don't understand it until...
we understood it, and they all understand. I think philosophically, you have to go back to the early 90s or mid-80s and the early 90s whenever this became an issue. Prior to the lawsuit in the early 90s, districts kept all the money they made off their tax base. Mm-hmm. And so you'd have districts with very, very rich, healthy tax bases that had literally millions, hundreds of millions of dollars more than maybe a neighboring district that was much more property poor. And a little district down in the valley area called Edgewood finally said enough's enough. And so they brought lawsuits. So Texas history, Edgewood versus the state of Texas, is a very famous case. Is the result of the second of those cases brought about Robin Hood.
Okay.
Which leads me to my point, or to address your question. I think philosophically, educators, we all understand that there needs to be some form of equitable funding across for all children, mm-hmm. whether I'm in Stafford, Texas, Spring Branch, or whether I'm in Ada, Texas. Where they live, their zip code, should not have that much of an influence on how much money is funded for them, because my kids in A-League were competing against the kids in Sundown ISD. If you're not familiar with Sundown, Sundown's a little small 2A district in the Panhandle where Marathon Oil plants their, $3-4 billion worth of oil wells. They do fine. Their pennies generate literally $80-90 million a penny. It's unbelievable. But the bottom line is they have to redistribute their money. So I don't think there's a disconnect. Here's where the disconnect is, if you want to call it that. And this was in Stafford. Our city officials, our school board, our community would say, listen, we've played by the rules that the state of Texas has put in place, and we've created an economic development system, business or residential. We've created a system that increases, incentivizes and increases business development. Naturally, your value is going to go up when your business development goes up. So why, what Stafford asked, why are we being punished by taking some of the money that we could otherwise provide for our constituents, our taxpayers, our parents? Why are we being punished and having that money siphoned off going somewhere else? Not stating that somewhere else doesn't need that money.
But the fundamental question is, why are we being punished for doing, playing by the rules of business development and economic development? That's where the disconnect sometimes comes.
And that's what I was looking for.
The second disconnect, this is real quick. Property wealthy does not mean student wealthy. Property wealthy means the values of your property are high. Does not mean the wealth from which your children come from is high. Sometimes it does. In very rare occasions it does. Highland Park in the Dallas area. That's wealthy children. The poor Texas, those are fairly wealthy. But you get into Stafford, you get into Deer Park, Deer Park's not a good example. You get into some of the districts along the Ship Channel, Channelview, those districts. Those districts are wealthy only because they have major business.
Porter.
We call them Smokestack 41.
Right.
They've got a lot of manufacturing, a lot of industry in Smokestack 41. There's a disconnect there because the state will look at that property value of Highland Park and place the same amount of weight on it as it does the property value in a Channelview ISD, where their children, 60% of their kids are economically disadvantaged. Stafford, 60% of their kids are economically disadvantaged. They're not wealthy by any stretch of the imagination. That's the big disconnect.
Okay.
I will tell you on taxable values, those are critical. One of my, and I've said this before, I think one of the things that this, the AD community has to deal with in the next 20, 30, 40 years is the value of the residential values. And as the community gets older, as homes get older, and there's less and less redevelopment of, for lack of a better word, master plan communities, you know, higher value single family dwellings, as that issue becomes more and more aged, then this district and other taxing entities within this district are going to struggle because the values will continue to decrease unless some type of reinvestment of infrastructure on the residential side takes place. And that's true in any urban setting. It just happens to be the urban setting on the west side. You go to the east side, you've got areas like Goose Creek and Baytown and some of those areas that are aging and they're having to reinvent themselves and determine how they're going to reinvest in their economic development. This community is no different. And I think it's already started, but I think there's a huge need for us to keep an eye on the values, residential values. Anything else?
Let me just follow up that comment. I can tell you that the Mission Bend area, our property values are falling to a rate of about 15% a year. And we have areas that fell as much as 50% in the last 4 years.
Yeah, it's an issue in a lot of areas. Dave, earlier your question about the word is that there's some property values that are rumored to be going up 15, 20, 25, all the way to 50%. I've heard the same thing. For certain businesses in certain areas of Harris County, some of the areas, as a matter of fact, I don't know if you've been having a question or something like that.
We haven't heard anything yet. But what's your mix? Is it like 50-50, residential and commercial?
Yeah, that's what I thought.
You know, you got, when I was in Stafford, we were in Fort Bend County 3 or 4 years ago, there was some sticker shock on the Fort Bend County Appraisal District coming back in and readjusting values. Because for so long, they had been undervaluing a lot of particularly the retail businesses along the Sugar Land Town Square and all that area. And so the comptroller came in and did a study of Fort Bend County on the values, particularly on the business side, and said, your values are way lower than what the comptroller's values are. So they were charged by the comptroller's office to raise their values. Well, some of those businesses raised their values, their values were raised 78%. And so what's the first thing you do if you're a taxpayer? What do you do when your values go up 70%? What do you do?
Protest.
You protest. You protest. Well, when you protest, which is your legal right as a taxpayer to protest against your values, you go in. The problem is sometimes those big protests take 2-3 years. And some of them take a long time because they can't be mediated in the appraisal district. Sometimes a lot of litigation follows. Well, as a taxing entity, this is what happened to Fort Bend ISD, Stafford, and Lamar. As taxing entities, some of these values went up so high, they couldn't mediate it, so it went to court. You know how the face of court. 3 or 4 years later, they would finally be resolved, and the courts may resolve them, and instead of 80%, they'd resolve them at 40%. Well, guess what the school district taxed that entity on? What value? The one at 80%. And that company, by law, had to pay that. But when their taxes were reduced, finally, 3, 4, 5 years later, down to 40%, then there's 40, those reductions are retroactive. So guess who has to write a check to pay that taxpayer back? However much money?
In district.
Local tax entities, school districts, MUDs, counties, hospital districts, emergency management districts, you name it. So we were in the process in little Stafford, Texas, of having to write huge checks back to Texas Instruments, who was one of them that protested, and National Oil. So Fort Bend ISD were writing major checks. And if you paid attention along that area of the Sherman Town Square, there were a lot of businesses going out of business, small retail, because they couldn't afford to rent. It was going up as a result of the tax rate. Tax base. So you got to be careful with those tax bases, because it could be it could backfire. How confused are you? All right. We are going to dismiss. You're more than welcome to stick around. I've got to get to St. Clair High School. Right in the road. If you haven't, we'll get this PowerPoint out along with some additional slides and 12 questions that you have. Our next meeting is when?
May 14th.
May 14th, I think. Is that right?
Yes.
We'll be sending out, we're going to wrap this up. One thing that I'd ask Craig to begin communicating with you guys on is, for those of you that may be interested in serving a second sentence and on this group, some of you may be enough's enough. Some may want to continue participating. I understand that. Some not been able to come to all the meetings, and so you may want another opportunity to try to attend. We're going to be putting together a combination. I hope we have some existing folks who want to stick around another year. We will try to make the topics meaningful, but I'd like to bring in some new parents and some new perspectives for those who are not interested in continuing. But we'll be kind of beginning to finalize that over the next 2 or 3 months, just so you guys know. But we'll wrap up on the 14th with the final meeting for this group, and we'll talk about moving forward, trying to get some feedback from you on what are ways we can improve this, what are ways we can continue to good positive dialogue with our community residents and all of us. Okay? Thank you for being here. Be safe going home. We'll see you on May the 14th. I'm going to go ahead and go.